Hello everyone, I'm Trey Rich, and on today's show we have Felipe Esparza tell us all about his new Netflix comedy special. Then it's Back to School with AP Bio. In our artist spotlight, we have Motown recording artist Joy Denalane, and then we check in with the first five finalists from this week's AGT Semi-Finals. Labor Day is over, which is very ironic because unemployment is at an all-time high. Halloween is canceled, and I haven't been to a party in 6 months. But what does it mean? I'll tell you what it means. It means when life hands you lemons, you grab those lemons and say, life, what the hell am I gonna do with these lemons? Get the heck out of here. Let's start the show.
Hi, my name is Felipe Esparza and you're on the bus.
AP Bio did two fun-filled seasons on NBC. A former philosophy professor played by Glenn Howerston takes a job teaching AP Biology, using his students to get back at the people in his life who have wronged him. Now on Peacock, season 3 is even more raunchy than the first two seasons. We check in with Lyric Lewis, Mary Sohn, and Jean Villapique to give us the season's school curriculum. Let's take a look.
My sex ed condoms came.
Oh,
and looks like I ordered enough to get the free dildo. Have a nice day.
Stop having those delivered to school.
Have you guys texted your friends about buying some cocaine? I'm not going down for this.
Damn!
Can we swear now?
I think so.
Holy s***.
Oh, you can expect, I feel like, the same shenanigans times 10. It's just so much fun. I feel like we really kind of let loose this season as far as the antics with the students. Jack, obviously, Helen, Patton's character, and also the teachers. We get out of the school more. I'm pregnant. So it's just a whole, the world is just bust wide open.
We shot all of that before COVID hit, and we actually were slated for 10 episodes, but we only got through 8. So it's actually very weird to finish that whole season and then not have addressed it at all. But yeah.
Peacock has, because it's streaming, there's a little bit of wiggle room with the time. So the episodes can go a little bit longer. They're not like colossal full feature length, but the jokes can have a little more life to them, or we can have like a couple looks after the jokes. It's really tight for network because it's like 21 minutes or something. So we have a little more freedom, and there's also some swearing. Some more swearing.
Well, the funny thing is that their running amok is still more responsible than any of the adults on the show, which I love. And Jean was saying before that these kids are so special that these AP Bio kids are not often the kids that you see in high school comedies. I think a lot of times we see a very sexy version of children. And yeah. These kids are like how real kids are. I know when I was 16, 17, I was a complete dork. So I really love that we highlight the kind of specialness of these very bright, brilliant children.
I always say Steph and Mary, the characters of Steph and Mary are teaching in high heels too. These folks are standing on their feet all day long. My husband and I have a lot of teachers in our family. And when I reached out to them when we were first working on the show, they were like, the kids are, like the kids put them in really crazy situations. It's so challenging and so much is expected of them. And now to be teaching on Zoom, they should be paid as much as doctors. They deserve so much more in this country, what they do in a day. And I think parents are realizing now that they're teaching from home, so maybe something will change.
And I teach improv, which still I feel like in comparison to teaching like math or history, but even the energy to do that for like 3 hours twice a week, I thought that was exhausting. And the thought of like, oh, every day, you know, a syllabus of this, of that, and coming and stimulating kids, like it is absolutely like the respect level is high. I mean, I just did what Jean said, like the fact that I see so many memes and so many people that are like, please come and get your children from my house now that they teach it. Please come and get him because they can't. It's a lot. And, you know, kids have dual personalities. They be cutting up at school and trying to act like angels at home.
You can see AP Bio Season 3 on Peacock TV, on a streaming site, Apple TV. If you have Roku, demand that they get Peacock.
Demand it.
And it comes out September 3rd. So put it in your calendars.
Don't call it a comeback.
AP Bio premieres Tuesday, September 1st on Peacock. So please check that out. Up next in our artist spotlight, we have Joy Denalane, so don't go away. And I don't ask for much. Just be gentle with your promises. Joy Denalane, who has been dubbed the German Queen of Soul, shares her U.S. debut album, Let Yourself Be Loved, via Motown Records. The album includes her singles, I Believe, I Gotta Know, and Top of My Love. Let's check out Joy in our artist spotlight.
Hi, folks. My name is Joy Denalane. I'm a singer, and I was born and raised in Berlin. That's in Germany. And that's where I'm having the conversation from right now. You struck right out of the blue. What's a girl to do? Oh, 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 oh. A simple twist of fate. Now there ain't no turning back. Sunshine or the pouring rain. Oh, 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 oh. I'm not that game. Well, I would definitely say that my father is mostly responsible for my musicals of socialization. He was a big record lover, and I would say he probably bought at least 5 to 10 records every weekend, and he would play them for us, he would play them for himself. And the good thing about my father's record collection was that he allowed us to play the records whenever we wanted. And so I was one of his children that did so. And I think that was when my whole DNA got together and, you know, where my whole, you know, love for soul music started, really. I think one of the first songs that really was widely spread was a duet that I recorded with a musician who turned out to become my husband and still is. It's a love song, and I will never forget, there was one time the European Music Awards, the MTV Music Awards in Dublin, and I met Whitney Houston there. Wow. And so she stopped me and she said, "You're the girl from the video. I love that song. I love the video. Go do your thing." And that was really impressive to me, because the song that we recorded and that I'm telling you about is a song that was sung in German, so with German lyrics. And even though she didn't understand a word, she seemed to like the song. Just half a hole. Your reflection lives in me. But I won't always be the eye for you to see. This is the craziest story ever. I mean, it's not really crazy, it's just so unexpected, and that's why I'm laughing. So I was just busy doing my album, and you know, the credo that I had, or the concept for the album to me personally was to just do music that I love without any compromise at all. And so once the album was finished and I played it for my label, they were kind of deeply impressed, I guess. And then one of the guys that I'm working with, he suggested to bring it to the States and introduce it to Motown. And when he said that, I was like, yeah, right. Okay, go ahead. And then he really came back with a heads up, and they said they wanted to do it. And I was like super overwhelmed, and it was, like I said, totally unexpected, especially because I didn't work to get signed on a label in the States. I just did my thing. I just did the music that I love. Yes, I do have an album. It's coming out. It's called Let Yourself Be Loved. And the interesting part about the record is that I wrote it in 2015 in New York. And I went there and worked with really great producers and composers and writers. And we pretty much put the album together quite fast. And then we started producing the record, and that's when I started thinking about how do I really precisely want the record to sound. And I think, you know, the intention behind it was to really make a soul album that is quite close to the era, let's say between maybe 75 and 79.
And I was quite explicit about it. And then it didn't really work out the way I wanted to for various reasons. So I put the album aside and produced another one. I produced another album that I released in 2017. And after the campaign was finished, I went back to the songs. And then I found a producer that I did the record with. And I am super, super happy. And the funny thing about the record was, so the first thing that he said once we talked on the phone and once I sent him all the demos, he said, you know what you need, Joy? You need a precision bass. You need a Fender precision bass. That's the first thing that we're going to do. And so he went, he lives in Munich. That's a town in the south of Germany. And then he took the train and went to another country, which is Switzerland, where he found the bass. So he bought the bass, the precision bass, went back to Munich, and then we started producing. So yeah. Well, they can follow me on Joy Denalane Instagram. They can follow me. I mean, they just have to type in my name, if I may say so. And then they find all the platforms that I'm on. And I talk to my fans as well. If they send me messages, I answer every now and then. And I think I'm quite active on Instagram, like I said. This is my main social media platform I like to spend time on. Hi, my name is Joy Denalane, and you just been buzzed.
Let Yourself Be Loved is out now on all streaming platforms. After the break, we talk to Felipe Esparza to tell us all about his Netflix comedy special. Stay right where you are. Most modern-day comedians dream of an opportunity to have a televised stand-up special, especially on the popular streaming platform Netflix. Felipe Esparza can now say he has joined the elite class of comedians with the announcement of not one, but two comedy specials. Bad Decisions, which will be in English, and also his Spanish-speaking special, Malas Decisiones. We got a chance to talk to Felipe as he gives us all the details.
Oh man, my Netflix special, I'm super excited. September 1st, not just one special, two specials. One in English, and the exact same special also in Spanish. I did two specials because, you know, Latinos, we do double the work.
It's not just Mexicans coming over. People from El Salvador, Nicaragua, Guatemala, Honduras, Peru, Venezuela. They come into America illegally, and they steal Mexican jobs. Are you fucking serious? We gotta make America great for Mexicans again.
The English set, I was offered by Netflix to do an English set for Netflix. I said yes, but then I countered them with, how about I throw in a Spanish set too? And they said, all right, but you speak Spanish. I said, yeah, better than you. And I was lying though. I spoke Spanish for the first 5 years of my life, and that's it. And then the rest was English because, you know, all the schools are in English. But I had to relearn Spanish. I had to go back to Mexico and do Spanish shows there because when I was doing Spanish shows in United States, everybody was laughing at everything. And when I would mess up a word, they would still laugh. So I had to go somewhere where if I mess up a word, they're going to call me on it. So I went to Mexico, and once I messed up a word, I got no laughs. So I'm in the right place. I'm going to learn here. I pulled 90% of my life experiences and made it into a stand-up set. But this comedy special on Netflix, Bad Decisions, is totally different from my last two because I'm like experimenting. I'm going dark on my comedy and talk about real life events that happened to me and make them funny, like domestic violence and child abuse and drug abuse and bad relationships and bad parenting. I had a fun childhood, you know, besides getting beat up by my parents and them my dad being alcoholic. The memories that I had growing up with my friends, growing up in the projects, we had a lot of fun growing up. Yeah, along the way, you know, we stopped break dancing and started gangbanging, but we have fun for the most part, you know, but then you grow up and you realize that all that fun wasn't really fun. It was just a waste of time, you know, but all that drugs and drinking, you know, it catches up to you. My mother, she had the opportunity to watch my whole set in New York City when I was in Manhattan. And at first, she was very surprised about the domestic violence joke because she you know, I don't know, anybody has ever dealt with domestic violence in America? I don't know if they ever talked about it or right. talked. We have never done that. We don't know how to, we know how to move on, but we don't know how to deal with it. So my mom and I had to deal with it that night, you know? Because we never dealt with it when I was 5 years old. So here we are. A grown man and a middle-aged woman dealing with something that that should have been dealt with 38 years ago. She laughed, first of all. She laughed at it now. She said, and then when the crowd was leaving, I said, that's my mom right there. She said, I'm his mom, and it didn't happen that way. He always brings up the bad parts of life. How come he never talks about the good parts? You know, like when I helped him with his math, when I took him to school, when he had a fever, I laid down with him. How come he don't make jokes about that? It's very therapeutic. And like white people say, it's very cathartic, right? Yeah, it's cathartic too. And I grow from this. This joke I say that's very dramatic, I've been dealing with that joke my whole life. Like I've been trying to put that joke and that memory behind me with drugs and addiction and gambling and substance abuse, everything just to hide from that memory. And now that I brought it up and talk about it, I don't think about it no more. I don't get sad about it. But I was sad in the beginning talking about it and saying on stage, like, I had to hold back tears whenever I would say that joke.
I don't want no drama from the ex guy. I wait in the porch for him when he picks up his kids. Listen, bro, you don't know me, man, but I don't want no problem from you. I know you're still making payments to this house. But I live here now, and I'm happy. Tu casa es mi casa.
Listen to the buzz and watch the buzz.
Bad Decisions and Malas Decisiones is now out on Netflix. Stay there. Ray will be talking to the first five acts that made it to the finals on AGT. She's back. AGT is coming down to the last few shows, and this season's finals are set to be a tight competition. Ray got a chance to talk to the first five finalists earlier this week to get their take on how they got where they are. Let's take a look.
This situation is so much bigger than you and me. This right here is generational healing because I'm getting married soon. And I want our first chapter together to be started off on the right page with you by my side as I marry my bride, because Tyrone, for the first time ever, I can honestly say, I love you.
Give me your reactions, your initial reactions from this kind of second wave and making it this far.
This just kind of takes me back to the beginning of my poetry career, like performing in front of like 3-4 people at a time physically. Because, you know, like we poets don't get top billing. Like we get Tuesdays and Thursdays after like the wonderful singers who are in the room take up Fridays and Saturdays. And so like, It took me back to my roots, and it takes me back to a place where I was really hungry for this art, and I continue to be hungry for it. So,
coming back to the semifinals, how does it feel? I think it feels amazing. I mean, I think everybody's gonna agree with me. Like it's a big deal to be on the semifinals, and only the best of the best is moving on. And you know, things are getting the competition is getting tougher and tougher because more and more people are sent home, unfortunately, and only the best of best is staying. But I think we feel accomplished. I think I can speak for everyone. Everyone feels so accomplished to be here in the semifinal, for sure. It is a big deal to be here. So I think everybody feels very good about it. I feel good about it.
It's an amazing feel. I told Terry during the interviews yesterday that it's immeasurable. You really cannot figure out a way to describe how cool it is to be where we're at right now. We've literally beat so many odds to be here. We were on the show, we were sent home, and then we got the blessing of a second chance. And we came back and we took that roller coaster ride and we're having fun with it. And to be where we're at right now is just surreal. And so we're so thankful. America is amazing to us right now.
This I'm very emotional now, especially about my daughter. It's when you're singing, you have to be emotional, especially if you're singing from your heart. I stay emotional.
All right. So how do you make sure that emotion almost doesn't either contributes to your performance or doesn't get in the way of making sure that you're on key, on pitch, doing your best?
Exactly. Like last night, for instance, they put my daughter on a screen and I had to turn my head the other way and sing the other way because if I'd have kept looking at her, they'd have had to come get me.
So it was so nice to make it this far. It felt so amazing. And it was just, I'm so grateful for this experience on AGT. It's just a dream come true. And not that many people get to go to the semis. And I'm just so grateful. If I make it to the finals, it's going to be like, wow, mind blowing. It's going to be a dream come true, like a major dream come true.
Alan, last time we talked about fear, I asked you if you were terrified and you said, no, not really. You know, everyone has fear, but it's about overcoming it. But, you know, then this time you took it to just another level altogether. So switching it up that kind of quickly and having to, you know, kind of come up with a new routine and adapt. How do you prepare for that in such a short amount of time?
Oh, thank you for this question. It's a really good question. And yes, it is hard to switch it up. It is hard to prepare in such a short amount of time because it was basically 1 week for me to put this together. But the thing is that I'm an aerialist, right? I'm not just an aerial silks artist. I'm an aerialist. I do aerial acts in general. So I think that really helped me to be able to apply my craft to, you know, other elements and other aerial acts. So I just wanted to make sure that I was able to do something different and show something different for the people at home, for America, so they can see versatility on me. You know, I can do other things too, right? So I think that, yeah, it's hard to tell you how we prepare. I think at this point, we are just on a go, go, go mode because everything happens so fast. We are for sure enjoying our journey, but it's like, okay, up to the next thing right away. So I think that's how we got there, basically.
Awesome. And then Broken Roots, so you guys gave us a nice kind of almost like a campfire vibe last night. And I wanted to see from you guys, when you're singing, there's a lot of passion coming out, but obviously you're having to play instruments, concentrate, you're on camera. How do you marry all of those things to make sure that your performance is what we felt last night, which is authentic and just very warm?
I think practice makes perfect. And I use the word autopilot a lot because there's a lot of factors that go into what we do, especially with this season in particular. I mean, there's a tremendous amount from production to ears to click tracks to this and that. There's so many things that are going on that if you pay attention to one thing, it's going to take you away from something else. So you have to trust that the team knows what they're doing. You have to trust that you know what you're doing. And then you just have to go for it. And when we go into autopilot, the only way we come out is if we hear something wrong. So if we don't hear that wrong, we kind of feel like we did okay because we both were so adrenaline rushed and feeling it that I looked at him after. I was like, I don't even remember. I don't remember it. Did we do good?
He was like, how'd we do? And I'm like, I don't know.
It's autopilot.
I disappeared,
you know?
For you, Roberto, what went into your song choice last night? I love that song, by the way, and you did an amazing job. But what went into choosing that song? What were you thinking?
Well, I love Pink. I love her songs. And one of my favorites is What About Us. I've been singing it for a long time now, but I thought it would be a great song for AGT because, you know, in the hard moments that we're living right now, everybody's thinking to themselves and asking them this very important question. What will come in the future? Like, are we gonna, is everything gonna go back to normal, or are we gonna be like in this COVID forever? I mean, there's a lot of things that can relate to this song, but the way I relate to it is in our present time right now. You know, people are asking themselves how the future will hold, what the future will hold for them. So I find that that's very important. And a very important phrase in there is like, you know, we are problems that need to be solved and we are children that need to be loved. And I believe that is such an inspiring phrase in that song. And very important for people to hear that, because a lot of people need that inspiration, especially children. And you know what, I believe that this world with hate, this world with love and hate both, I wish we can have all love, and we need to get all the hate out, because with the world that we have, we should be grateful for it, and we really need to fulfill it. We need to fulfill our life, because life is too short and we just need to live it. So I believe that this song was a great song for AGT, and I hope everyone liked it.
Thank you guys so much. I really hope to talk to you guys again. Of course, if I talk to you guys again, that's an amazing thing, because that means we have moved along. So nice to see you guys.
AGT is on NBC Tuesday and Wednesday, so be sure to check your local listings. Stay put, I'll be right back to wrap this all up. That's all we have. Special thanks to Ray Williams, the cast of AP Bio, Felipe Esparza, AGT, NBC, Netflix, and Lemons. Don't forget to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, and double tap us on Instagram, all at buzz_access. Please wear your mask, wash your hands, and be respectful to everyone. We are all in this together. I'm Trey Rich, love and light to you all.
I don't know what you've been told about the things you're doing to me. I can't lie, I was on cloud nine, but it just wasn't enough for me. Girl, you take me higher, so high I can't come down.
For more stories and extended clips, go to thebuzzallaccess.com. I'm Trey Rich, and you've just been buzzed.